Hello and welcome back to another episode of Tech Champions. I'm your host, Daniel Beaty, CTO with AuditMax in Jacksonville, Florida. As you know, we take time each week to sit down with thought leaders and industry experts in the field of technology. We learn about their journey and their mission and get their perspective on the latest trends in the industry. We always have amazing guests on the show. Today is no exception. Joining us from Boxford, Massachusetts is Michael McGovern. Michael, welcome to the show.
Hey, Dan. Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing great. So how are things up north? You getting those crisp fall mornings yet?
We are. It's, yesterday was about 35 degrees in the morning. It was pretty cold.
Yeah. We're in Jacksonville, but I read somewhere that our low overnight was actually cooler than yours for some reason.
Wow.
I don't know. We got a little cold snap there. So, but yeah, let's talk a little bit about your history. I know, you graduated from UMass, you spent a number of years at Juniper, and then you kind of made that jump into the financial services industry, and currently SVP, CTO, CISO, a lot of acronyms there with Metro Credit Union. So tell us a little bit about your journey to this point, your current role.
Yeah, again, thanks for having me. I started the first half of my career actually in high-tech organizations with pretty well-established companies like GE Aerospace, 3Com Corporation, Telebit Corporation, and as you mentioned, Juniper Networks, even though I was at Juniper for only about 4 months. Juniper actually ended up purchasing a company that I worked for, which is a private company called Unisphere Networks. And with that purchase and restructuring that Juniper was doing, I unfortunately was handed my pink slip and took the summer off. And actually, because of networking, I ended up getting a call from an individual by the name of Ron Orazine, who actually helped us in getting circuits installed in a new facility that we were building. We were getting install dates that were 3 months after our move-in date, and that just doesn't work very well for a telecommunications company. So Ron ended up giving me a call and said that, you know, he was doing some consulting work down at Cambridge Trust Company. And long story short, I went down there, had a 15-minute conversation with the CIO, and I became the information security manager there. And then later on, about 10 months after that, I took the information technology role over at Cambridge Trust. And it was at Cambridge Trust for 10 years. And driving home one day, I ended up getting a phone call from an executive search firm. Metro Credit Union was looking for a chief technology officer. And that's where I am today at Metro Credit Union.
All right. That's great. I love that story. That's fantastic. And I know part of your personal story involves your grandparents. You want to share a little bit about their influence on you?
Yeah, sure. Well, my mom and my dad split when I was about one year old. And I ended up with my mom moving into my grandparents' house. And my mom worked second shift. And so I spent a lot of time with my grandparents, which, you know, to this day, I say, what a great experience. And luckily enough, my grandfather is still alive and he's 85 years old. But, you know, they both had a very, very good and very strong work ethic. They were very supportive of me in anything that I did. Most importantly, my education, and was one of the first family members to actually go to college and actually get his degree. So, again, so lucky to have them in my life. Some of the things, you know, my grandfather was a World War II veteran. Him and his four brothers went off to World War II and came back. So some of the stories that I heard growing up were unbelievable.
I'm sure. Yeah, no, that's great. And honestly, Michael, that's, you know, that's more and more rare these days as we kind of spread out as a society to be close to grandparents and have that kind of effect. That's great. That's a huge privilege. So thanks for sharing that. You know, I know everyone's been busy during this pandemic. It's been a crazy year for sure, but you've had an extraordinary number of projects going on. You've been forklifting ATMs and rolling out thin clients, migrating to Office 365, I know one of the projects that you're most proud of involves that DR and business continuity. Can you tell our audience about some of those, some that project and some of your other recent ones?
Yeah, sure. So, the pandemic hit us around the March timeframe. We went from a pretty much 100% in-house environment to over a 3-week period, moving all our employees to work out of their homes, which is a feat in and of itself. But again, it was a lot of teamwork between all the different departments at Metro, along with information technology, to make that happen. But as part of this whole thing, we actually had to think about doing our core conversion. We started a project about 3 years ago, which was what we called Operation Transformation. And that was really to take a look at our overall technologies and really look at what we needed to do in order to drive Metro forward the next 10, 15, 20 years. And so we've completed that core conversion that actually happened in, over Columbus Day weekend. And that was really teamwork between information technology, the business lines, the project management office at Metro, our new third-party vendor, which is called COCC, as well as a third-party consultant that's really been part of the overall journey with us to get us where we are today. But we just didn't do a core conversion. We actually, as you said, forklifted 38 ATMs and replaced those ATMs with new state-of-the-art ATMs, changed our card payment rails, changed our instant issue technology, outsourced a lot of the components that we originally had in-house, and we did that all 100% remote. So again, a great accomplishment by everybody at Metro Credit Union to make that happen. One of the things that you talked about was disaster recovery and business continuity. That's something that I've actually taken on for several different roles, not only at Cambridge Trust, but at Metro Credit Union, to really look and see if an organization has a disaster recovery business continuity plan. And if they don't have one, what do we need to do in order to get there? What's the roadmap? How do we define what technologies we need to be put in place? May it be either in-house technology or cloud technology, and then executing on that plan. And I would have to say, very proud of what I've been able to do with my teams at both Cambridge Trust and Metro Credit Union to get there. Again, as you know, Dan, technology changes annually, but every 3 years there's a big technology shift. And when I first looked at technology at Metro as to do we want to keep it in-house or do we want to put it in a cloud environment, cloud technology was pretty expensive 6 to 7 years ago. You're talking three times the cost. Where 3 years after that, it was kind of a one-to-one. And then people started to move into the cloud because of that, because of 24 by 7 by 365 support. And then hyperconverged technology came 3 years after that, which now people started to bring technologies back into the organization. So,
Right.
as you know, there's this whole ebb and flow, and technologies are changing, and you really have to look at that, and you have to be kind of a forward thinker and think 3 to 5 years out and say, what do I need to do in order to be where I need to be 3 to 5 years out? So,
Yeah, that's great. That's
but
great.
disaster recovery is always changing, and with our core conversion and really outsourcing a lot of the components of our environment that used to be in-house, we're going to have to rewrite our disaster recovery plan again and start working with our vendors to understand how we go about testing the plan and making sure that all these third parties are meeting our expectations.
Yeah, that's great, Michael. I love to hear when people like yourselves and companies like Metro Credit taking initiative on a business continuity and DR side. Unfortunately, so many of the much of the time I see companies address that after they've been after they've lost data or been hacked or something else. So I love to see it when people take an initiative and honestly the leadership of the company sees that as important. So that's awesome. I love it. Tell us for a minute how you made that decision between the on-prem and the cloud compute. Can you talk a little bit about how you were able to make that decision?
Yeah, it was a hard decision to make. Everybody's used to, controlling their own destiny, and typically you do that by, running your technologies in-house and having the appropriate team and staff that has the skill sets in order to support it. But really, organizations that are the size of Metro, Metro is the number one state chartered credit union in Massachusetts, $2.3 billion in assets, about 350 employees. But again, competition, right? You need to be able to play like the big boys and the new fintechs. And competition is fierce. You're getting competition from non-traditional players. And because of that, we really needed to think out of the box and really be a 24 by 7 by 365 organization. And the best way to do that, based on our size and based on the employees and a number of people that it takes in order to be 24 by 7 by 365, outsourcing was really the right solution for Metro. And it was really a concerted effort between all of our senior management team and our board of directors in order to go this direction.
Yeah, that's great. thanks for sharing that information. And I know a lot of folks are kind of in that same boat where they're trying to make a decision like that, and they're going, HCI or cloud. So I appreciate your insight there for sure. So you're CISO. It's one of your titles there. I have a question for you. If you were in a room full of CISOs, what's one piece of advice that you'd give them?
Well, I don't know if it'd just be one piece. I think at the end of the day, what I've learned in working in the financial institution industry the last 18 plus years is that there is no holy grail when it comes to information security. You really need to understand that it's just not one piece of hardware or one piece of software. It's really having a defense in depth model. And we have one at Metro. It has seven layers. The first layer being data. We really want to protect our members' data. But it really takes a combination of a lot of things: hardware, software, training, assessments, monitoring, alerting, policies and procedures. All of those things need to occur in order to build a really good, robust information security plan to protect your members' data. Another thing that I would also say to them would be it's really important to balance security with the ability for your employees to actually do their work. I mean, you can tighten things down so much that employees just are not capable of being able to do their day-to-day functions.
Right.
So those would be the two things that I would think are really important for a CISO. As a takeaway.
Gotcha. Okay, no, that's great. I love it. And there's definitely a balance there. We've all seen that working from home, trying to set up our VPNs and connectivity back there. So unfortunately, we do have to wrap up the show, but I do want to ask you one final question since we're called tech champions. What's one characteristic you think it takes to become a tech champion?
Well, here's another one that I said there's more than just one, right? It really has to be the love and passion that you have for the role that you play within our organization, and being a person that you can be looked at as a mentor, not only by people at your level or people within your organization, but your team. One of the things that I really like to do is actually mentor my team. Unfortunately, sometimes I do such a great job that those individuals have to actually leave the organization because they are advancing their career. I think that really makes a great leader is somebody that can actually do that. One of the things that I always say is when I was at Cambridge Trust, I was there for 10 years. And I finally, after 10 years, created a team that I was very proud of. And unfortunately, I left myself in order to advance my career. I think those are the things that really make a tech champion. I also think that an individual needs to be able to think out of the box and be a really be a forward thinker and actually really rolling up your sleeves on a day-to-day basis. I think it's really important that you understand technologies and understanding the roles and responsibilities of your team. It just makes you more relevant.
Gotcha. Okay, that's great. Love it. A lot of good stuff there. I like the passion piece and the mentorship as well. All and everything. Those are all super important. So, hey, Michael, thank you for being on the show. If people want to reach out and find you, what's the best way for them to do that?
They can either, I think the best thing to do is, I use it a lot, is LinkedIn. So you can find me on
Okay.
LinkedIn.
Okay, great. And thank you again for being on the show. Really appreciate the time today. And to our audience, thank you for being our audience today on Tech Champions. And I'm Daniel Beaty. We'll see you next time.